The Iron Mountain report also suggests that an effective substitute for war would require alternate enemies. It goes on to say that gross pollution of the environment could eventually replace the mass destruction by nuclear weapons as a threat to the survival of the human species. The report further states that poisoning of the air and the principal sources of food and water supply is already well advanced. And just as Dr. Carol Rosen stated, the report included that an alien invasion threat was a serious component to this war substitute planning. It has been highly argued that an external alien menace would offer the last best hope of peace, etc., by uniting mankind against the danger of destruction by creatures from other planets or from outer space. Experiments have been proposed to test the credibility of an out-of-our-world invasion threat. It is possible that a few of the more difficult-to-explain flying saucer incidents of recent years were in fact early experiments of this kind. Thus, the evil money masters now use their limitless wealth to fashion fantastic technologies to further their obsessive lust for omnipotent control over the human population, to ultimately re-engineer our race into a totally monitored assembly line of anesthetized, homogenized, lobotomized robot cyborgs. The great body of the people mentally incapable of comprehending the tremendous advantages that capital derives from the system will bear its burdens without complaint and perhaps without even suspecting that the system is inimical to their interests. The enemy within is in truth the inertia of mass public complacency and ignorance, and a handful of cunning, predatory, ambitious men use this to their own advantage. And by so doing, these men have gained unto themselves fantastic wealth and global political power, while reducing the rest of the planet's population into oblivious, submissive debt slaves. In 1776, the brilliant architects of America's Constitution specifically designed a government to protect its citizens against the chronic plague of political abuses dispensed by European monarchies for centuries. But this constitutional system is only as effective as the steadfast vigilance of the nation's citizens to protect and maintain it. We the people have been mandated with this responsibility and are the only ones who can serve this duty. We the people are the only ones who can deliver ourselves from political or economic slavery, whether imposed from without or imposed from within. The great tragedy of World War II was not that a ruthless, homicidal dictator led his country to total destruction, but that the vast population of a great, God-fearing, Christian German nation complacently stood by and allowed him to do so. Sadly, the citizens of each nation ultimately get the government they deserve. John F. Kennedy was the last president to actually fight for the Constitution. And when he died, rather than take up his crusade, the American people looked the other way. And conversely, our nation is once again burdened with the same chronic economic and political abuses the Founding Fathers fought to liberate us from 200 years earlier. Since November 1963, Kennedy's 9 successors have been carefully appointed custodians who obediently serve the vast money interests that placed them into power. Modern presidential candidates have become irrelevant mannequins that posture and parade before television cameras to maintain a facade of popular party politics. But once in office, they simply serve the masters who finance their elections. So, how many more courageous leaders have to die? How many more trade towers have to blow up? How many more American soldiers have to be sacrificed in needless wars? How many more impotent presidents must we endure before the people of this nation will rise up and take their country back? When will we the people finally triumph over the enemy within?
I don't want to be an emperor. That's not my business. I don't want to rule or conquer anyone. I should like to help everyone if possible. Jew, Gentile, black man, white. We all want to help one another. Human beings are like that. We want to live by each other's happiness, not by each other's misery. We don't want to hate and despise one another. In this world, there's room for everyone, and the good earth is rich and can provide for everyone. The way of life can be free and beautiful, but we have lost the way. Greed has poisoned men's souls, has barricaded the world with hate, has goose-stepped us into misery and bloodshed. We have developed speed, but we have shut ourselves in. Machinery that gives abundance has left us in want. Our knowledge has made us cynical, our cleverness hard and unkind. We think too much and feel too little. More than machinery, we need humanity. More than cleverness, we need kindness and gentleness. Without these qualities, life will be violent, and all will be lost. The aeroplane and the radio have brought us closer together. The very nature of these inventions cries out for the goodness in men, cries out for universal brotherhood, for the unity of us all. Even now, my voice is reaching millions throughout the world, millions of despairing men, women, and little children, victims of a system that makes men torture and imprison innocent people. To those who can hear me, I say, do not despair. The misery that is now upon us is but the passing of greed, the bitterness of men who fear the way of human progress. The hate of men will pass and dictators die, and the power they took from the people will return to the people. And so long as men die, liberty will never perish. Soldiers, don't give yourselves to brutes. Men who despise you, enslave you, who regiment your lives, tell you what to do, what to think, and what to feel, who drill you, diet you, treat you like cattle, use you as cannon fodder. Don't give yourselves to these unnatural men, machine men with machine minds and machine hearts. You are not machines. You are not cattle. You are men. You have the love of humanity in your hearts. You don't hate. Only the unloved hate, the unloved and the unnatural. Soldiers, don't fight for slavery. Fight for liberty. In the 17th chapter of St. Luke it is written, the kingdom of God is within man, not one man nor a group of men, but in all men, in you. You, the people, have the power. The power to create machines, the power to create happiness. You, the people, have the power to make this life free and beautiful, to make this life a wonderful adventure. Then in the name of democracy, let us use that power. Let us all unite. Let us fight for a new world, a decent world, that will give men a chance to work, that will give youth a future and old age a security. By the promise of these things, brutes have risen to power, but they lie. They do not fulfill that promise. They never will. Dictators free themselves, but they enslave the people. Now let us fight to fulfill that promise. Let us fight to free the world, to do away with national barriers, to do away with greed, with hate and intolerance. Let us fight for a world of reason. A world where science and progress will lead to all men's happiness. Soldiers, in the name of democracy, let us all unite!